And now, a fireside chat with Arthur Bergeron.
Hi, and welcome back. My name is Arthur Bergeron. I am an attorney at Myrick O'Connell. There are 68 of us there, and I do nothing but elder law. I have the luxury of being able to do that because the other 67 people know about all the other areas of law that my clients ever seem to need to know about. So what I decided to do a while ago was just to develop a call-in show, and this is it, in order to be able to answer specific questions that people have sometimes raised when I'm doing my seminars at senior centers or even in client meetings, so that you can try to understand how to deal with these problems. So the lines are open. We're waiting for questions. Often I've been getting calls from my good friends, Frank and Mary. You may have seen them if you've been to any of my seminars. And I always enjoy talking to them or anybody else who may be calling. So let's see who's on the line today.
Hello, Mr. Bergeron. It's Frank again.
Oh, Frank. It's been ages.
It's good to talk to you again. My question today is that my older brother has been taking care of his wife at home, but he just can't manage it anymore. He would like to keep his wife home, but he needs a lot of help. What can he do?
So, Frank, that's not an uncommon problem, especially for folks. No, I shouldn't say especially for folks. For most couples who have been aging at home and, of course, want to stay at home until they die, which I know from having talked to you and your wife, Mary, before, that's your goal, at least, right? And I'm sure it's your brother's. And so the question is, if one of the spouses really starts getting frail, so that the other spouse, like your brother's wife, so that your brother just can't be taking care of her because he's really old too, so he may not be able to lift her up. He may be just worried that while he can take care of her most times, he can't take care of her around the clock. The question is, what can he do? Well, the answer is if his wife has developed some serious medical problems, if she needs assistance with at least two of the activities of daily living, and the activities, and by the way, by assistance, I mean assistance by another person, right? With at least two of the activities of daily living, and they are eating, bathing, dressing, toileting, you know, using the bathroom and using the shower, and transferring. And transferring means getting up out of a chair, basically walking across the room and sitting down without the assistance of a person. If she needs assistance from a person in order to do two of those five things, or if she really needs to have someone constantly there, as I know your brother is constantly there, because otherwise it may be dangerous for her because she has one of the diseases that cause dementia and her dementia symptoms are getting worse, because she may just kind of drift out of the house because she's at much higher risk of falling because of that dementia. If that's the situation, then your brother's wife may be eligible for medically eligible for a program called the Frail Elder Waiver. This is a program that's funded by MassHealth. MassHealth is the Massachusetts name for the Medicaid program. As you probably know, Medicaid is a joint program that is jointly funded by the federal government and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The Frail Elder Waiver is a program designed to keep people at home even though their medical condition would otherwise qualify them for nursing home care. And that's the standard for whether or not you need nursing home care that MassHealth would pay for. Do you need assistance with at least two of the activities of daily living, or do you need constant supervision? So in that situation, your brother's wife may be medically eligible for MassHealth. And by the way, to find out whether she is, she should contact someone from the regional ASAP in which she lives. The ASAP, you're asking? An ASAP is an Aging Services Access Point, ASAP or ASAP. In this area, in Marlboro, Northboro, Westboro, Hudson, and many of the communities that I work in regularly, and also Hopkinton, Ashland, Sudbury, in those communities, the ASAP is Bay Path Elder Services. That is the entity that MassHealth would want to have a letter from indicating that your brother's wife is medically eligible. Now, if she can show that she is, then she will be eligible to have MassHealth pay for probably as much as 40 or 50 hours a week of home care, right? As long as she can show that she is financially eligible. So let me talk a little bit about those rules. For your brother's wife to be financially eligible, she has to show that she has less than $2,000 in countable assets. I would bet you if they're living in their own house, they have more than that, because among other things, they have the house and I'm sure they've got a lot, they've got cash. Your brother though can own the home itself. There's no limit on the value of the house. It can be worth $1 million. There is no equity limit. He can also have cash or cash equivalent assets. That is assets that could be turned into cash, like stocks, bonds, IRAs, 401ks, mutual funds, all those things. But the total value of those assets can't be more than $120,900. But in addition to that, your brother can have unlimited income. Therefore, if your brother and his wife, like so many of my clients, have a house that may be worth $300,000 or $400,000, have other things, IRAs, annuities, cash, various things worth, say, $300,000 or $400,000, all that they have to do is have his wife transfer all the assets to him, or at least the assets that keep the wife below $2,000. So as a practical matter, just have him transfer all the assets to him. Then have him take all of the assets that are over $120,900 and buy an annuity with them. What kind of annuity? A very specific kind. It has to be an annuity that calls for equal monthly payments to your brother over a term that does not exceed his actuarial life expectancy. Remember, I said his actuarial life expectancy, not his actual life expectancy. So no matter what your brother's health is, his life expectancy will be determined according to a life expectancy chart. As you can expect, this is the government. We got a million charts here, right? And a life expectancy chart that will say, based on his age, what his life expectancy is. To give you a sense of that, if your brother were 88 years old, he would have a life expectancy right now of about 5 years. So and the annuity that he buys has to be shorter than his life expectancy. So if his wife needed to qualify for the frail elder waiver, we would shift all the assets to him. Say that was $400,000. Say we'd have him keep $100,000 because he can keep up to 120. Use the other $300,000 to buy an annuity. As long as that annuity calls for equal monthly payments over a term that does not exceed his actuarial life expectancy, the day after he buys the annuity, she can qualify for MassHealth and be eligible for, as I say, as much as 40 or 50 hours of home care. Now, a couple of caveats. First, while the current rules say that when Frank buys that annuity, oh, and by the way, before I get to the caveats, I just want to give you a sense of what this means in terms of numbers. Suppose that Frank bought a $300,000 annuity and that he was doing it for 5 years. There are 12 months in a year, so there were 60 months in those 5 years. $300,000 divided by 60 months is $5,000 a month. So what Frank would be getting back every month from that annuity would be $5,000. So that Frank, or excuse me, what your brother should be getting back every month will be about $5,000. So your brother shouldn't be fearing that by doing all these restructuring, he's going to leave himself a pauper, unable to pay his bills. Okay? That said, though, a couple of caveats. One, while under current rules, if your brother buys that annuity, he can specify that if he dies during that 60-month period, the remaining payments, the remaining $5,000 a month payments that are owed to him, can be paid to anybody he wants. Under a proposed MassHealth reg change, that rule will change. And if there are any remaining payments left to your brother at the time of his death, and if Mary in the meantime was on MassHealth and MassHealth had paid for any of her care, MassHealth would have a lien on those remaining payments to get repaid. Therefore, your brother's strategy should be to buy an annuity that has the shortest life possible so that he can get all of his money back quickly. Why is that? Because as long as your brother, having done all of these things, changes his will so that he says that following his death, whatever assets he has, instead of going to his wife, which is probably what the will now says, will go in trust for the benefit of his wife, and he can name one of his kids or somebody else, he can name you if he wanted to as the trustee. And if he then dies, all of the assets that he has, like the house, which has been transferred to him, the $100,000 that we just talked about, and any of these payments that have come back to him, will now all be safe because they'll go in trust for Mary's benefit, be lien free, MassHealth will not be able to put a lien on those funds, and non-countable. So at that point, none of those assets will cause Mary, or excuse me, will cause your brother's wife to lose her MassHealth benefits. So your brother really does have a strategy to, and it's a fairly straightforward one. Once again, to summarize, he should transfer all of the assets to just his name. He should then buy an annuity with all of the assets that are over $100,000. So I hope that I hope that answers your question. And for all of those of you who've been listening in, I hope if you've got a problem like that, I hope that that answers your question. And I look forward to seeing you again in one of these call-ins. Thank you very much.